institute, training institute, because they were undergoing training. After their selection, they were undergoing training for 2 years. And this Master in Public Policy program of Indira Gandhi National Open University in New Delhi was for 2 years. So every 6 months, I used to conduct their examination, and I used to send question papers, and then I used to upload the results of the IAS professionals. So what I mean to say is that the government of India has realized that public policy making is such an important area that every IAS who becomes a SDO, a ADM, a DM, then a secretary, a commissioner, should pass through or should clear a course on public policy. So that is the importance government of India has attached to public policy. And last year, some students have requested me that, sir, not many public universities in India are offering a course on public policy. Why don't you start a master degree in public policy? So with that initiative and feedback from the students, we started a course on public policy. So this is how we are now. The course has got a reasonable number of students, but it is a part of MA Public Administration. Though MA Public Administration and MA Public Policy are two separate subjects, but they are interrelated. And then political science is also interrelated. So I expect political science students, MA Public Administration students, MA Public Policy students to participate. I'm very happy to know from Vigneshwar, my colleague in Orissa Open University, that some students of Utkal University have joined. Some administrative cadre officers of Orissa have also joined this program. I welcome all of them. And with these few opening remarks, I request Professor Swarna Mai Tripathi Madam to start the discussion on approaches to public policy. I request the students to keep their mic mute, and if they have any comments to make after half an hour, they can use the chat box to note down their questions, their suggestions, their remarks, and their observations. Thank you very much. Professor Swarna Mai Tripathi, please.
Thank you, Mr. Vice Chancellor. A very good morning, dear students. Public policy, I have the impression that you find the subject very difficult, but it is very interesting. We know that public policy, the word is frequently used in our daily lives. It is very popular to us, not to the students of public administration, not to the students of all science or the administrators. For a common man also, the word policy is very, very common. Like we say health policy, we say education policy, we say food policy. So that is how, you know, policy means people understand that it is framed by the government to satisfy public needs and demands. And why it is so important? Because a successful government means the government has successful policy. The government has successfully implemented the policy. A failed government or a failed state means the policies are inappropriate, the policies are not contextual, not problem oriented, not serving the needs of the people. So that is the real core of the subject, which actually creates interest among the administrators, among the students, and among the common man. Now I must tell you, the policy science is basically, we think that it is a post Second World War concept. But actually, if we understand, policy or public policy is very, very old, very, very ancient, in the sense that you can trace the origin of public policy to the beginning of civilization. Because whenever we had a very thoughtful ruler, take for example the Mughal Emperor Akbar, the mythologists say that the King Bharat, by whose name we have got the name Bharat. So, they also consulted many intelligent people, formulated their policy, and they thought that the public policy is for the people. And gradually, the word policy carried the adjective that it is public policy. But there is no antonym for it. I mean, there is nothing called private policy. The word policy itself signifies that it is public policy. Now, whatever policies we see today, people try to categorize it into different parts, into different categories. But however, in 1964, a theorist in public administration, Theodore Louis, he said, we have just three types of public policies. One public policy which regulates the behavior of the inhabitants or the citizens, like we have the Motor Vehicle Act. We have distributive public policies where we actually, the government makes efforts to distribute the resources, the national resources, the common resources, which belongs to all. It needs to be regulated. It needs to be distributed on a rational basis. Then we have redistributive policies. Now, redistributive policies, there is debate regarding this concept. What is this redistributive policies? The way if I earn more, then I have a larger responsibility towards the state, and I must pay more taxes in the form of income tax to the government. That is redistributive policy. That means compulsorily, in a coercive way, the government will take out 30% of my salary if I earn more. And that will be the contribution from my side to the social sector development of the state. So that is how the policies have been categorized. Now I must tell you, our emphasis on public policy has begun when we realized that public administration is just not institutional in nature. Public administration is clinical in nature. Now, I use the word clinical in the sense that every public policy is a prescription for the social or economic problems of the society. Like the doctor provides us a prescription for treating our disease. That is how the government makes a public policy to solve the problems of the people. That is how the writers in public administration, they have said that public administration is clinical in nature. When we realized that public administration is clinical in nature, then simultaneously we had also developed behavioral sciences. We had also developed scientific methods of research, and in the process we realized that there must be a science of policy or public policy. And this idea came to a theorist in political science, Harold Lashwell, who is considered as a communication theorist to the students of political science, to the students of public administration, and to the students of mass communication. Now, Harold Lashwell, in 1951, wrote an article, Policy Orientation, in the book, The Policy Sciences, which he co-edited with Daniel Lerner. Now, Daniel Lerner is a theorist in modernization, who talked about the passing of traditional societies. Now, their main concern, like that group, was that the journey from traditional society to modern society is a journey from non-scientific to scientific understanding. So they said, if you are a modern human being, then you must have scientific temper, you must be secular, you must believe in merit-based society, you must believe in an achieved society rather than an ascribed society. So that is how Harold Laswell, in 1951, started writing on public policy and said, now public policy needs separate attention in the sense that it needs to be viewed scientifically, because public policy is common to all forms of state, whether it is a democratic state, whether it is a monarchical state, whether it is a military dictatorship. Every state is having public policy. So as the constitution is common to every country, so the work of public policy making is also common to every country. And this, actually, this urge to make more and more scientific policies began in the later half of 19th century in United States of America, basically towards the end of fag end of 19th century, when there was a movement in United States that is called Progressive Movement, and the members of that movement decided that, you know, that is the beginning of public administration, where they said that public policy is a scientific exercise, and if we approach it scientifically, then it will be easier to solve the problems of public administration. Now, afterwards, what we find is that even in a very, very scientific way, Frederick Winslow Taylor talked about scientific management, which today we also follow. In 1831, let me tell you, in New York University, they decided to give admission on merit basis. And this is how you can trace the origin of scientific policy making in the global society, and which culminated in a policy science in the Second World War era in 1950s, when gradually we realized that public administration interacts with the given environment, that means the political system of any country interacts with the given environment, and it cannot be made in isolation. It must respond to the demands, the supports, the resources that are there in different systems. That is, you can say the social system, the economic system, the cultural system, so on and so forth. So I must tell you, students here, that we must understand, is there any difference between policy for analysis and policy of analysis? That means, is it possible to say that, let me put it otherwise, analysis of policy or analysis for policy? Now, when we're talking about analysis for policy, it is talking about the policy making process. When you are talking about analysis of policy, it is something about the policy analysis, or you can say the evaluation of the public policy. Now, when Harold Laswell, if we talk about Lasswell's theory, when Harold Lasswell talked about policy science in the beginning, he said, public policy is having three features, very, very core features. One is multidisciplinary in nature. Second is, it is contextual, about which I have already spoken. And the third is, I mean, the normative aspect. That means, you know, it's it borrows the knowledge of from other social sciences, other aspects of human mind, human society, and tries to address the given problem that is there before us. And third is that while addressing the problems, we cannot compromise societal values that is there in the society, because we cannot make any policy or any law which will be thrust on the people. People must accept it. That is how the legitimacy of the government is generated. So therefore, when the government, when the policymakers are addressing the problems, they have to keep in mind the normative, the societal values of the society. So that is how every public policy has a normative content. And later on, all political scientists, all theorists in public administration have believed in this. They have developed a consensus regarding the nature of public policy. Now, let me tell you, what is this? When you are talking about approaches to public policy, what exactly are we talking about? Now, whatever literature we have on public policy, you can divide it into two parts. One is the functional aspect of the public policy, like the formulation, the, you can say, the implementation and the evaluation of the public policy. The other is the theoretical approach to study public policy. I mean, you can just say, what is the approach of the policymaker while making the policy? Or you can say, you can just analyze the policy cycle or the policy process. So I must, we must start from the beginning. Like, it is better if we understand the state as the way public, so political science theorists have defined conventionally, that is, political science is a study of state and government. That means here we are just focusing on the public institutions. We are not focusing on the different groups in society or the different values in society or the different systems that is there in the larger social system. Now, if we try to study public policy in this sense, then it is called institutional approach. Now, here, the those who studied public policy in the sense, like the traditional theorists, you know, you can call them as the early theorists, they said that public policy is an institutional output. People have nothing to do with it. It is determined by the government. It is universal in character, applicable to all people. That means the targeted population. It originates from the legislature or the executive or the judiciary. It addresses the public interest. That is why it is called public policy, because it is determined for the welfare of the people. So this is how you see, initially, our approach was to create institutions which will give special focus on different aspects of public policy. Like in our constitution, we did not incorporate the planning commission, but in 1950, we decided to create a separate institution that is called the planning commission, which will whose work will be specifically to prepare, to map the resources of the country and to prepare the plan for the country. You know, this can be called as the institutional approach. Now, what are the challenges that the theorist faced by following this institutional approach? Now, number one is such institutional changes may not always produce desired consequences. Like we realize that planning commission is not serving our purpose. Then we created the National Development Council. Today we have the Niti Aayog. Because, you know, we are gradually feeling that the institution is not serving the desired consequences. The theorists neglected the influence of environment on policy making and intended policy impact. Analysis of the policy impact was given negligible focus. So that is how, you know, institutional approach could not continue further. Now, theorists also identify another approach, which is basically borrowed from political science, that is the elite theory. Now, it's the elite theory, you know, it's a critical perspective to look at a democratic, liberal democratic state, which ultimately said democracy in real sense doesn't exist at all. The Italian sociologists like Gilfred Pareto, Gaetano Mosca, you know, these people, they said that the whole society is divided into elites and non-elites. The elites, those who rule, and the non-elites who are governed, who have nothing to tell about the public policy. And in the elites also, some philosophers, they divided the elites into governing elite and non-governing elite. Now, let me tell you the features of the elite theory. It says that public policy is a piece of document reflecting the preferences of the governing elite. People do not care much about the policies. People are not having the knowledge about policies and knowledge about how the government goes on. And here the public policy flows from top to bottom. People have nothing to tell about it. Now, this is how the elite theory interpreted the policy-making process. Now, the elite theory was also questioned where they said that it is not that a particular elite or a group of elite is dominating the scene, the political system. It is actually the interaction of the groups, the society, is a pluralistic society where different groups interact with each other, compete with each other, conflict with each other, and try to influence public policy. And these groups in political science are called as interest groups or pressure groups. Now, they said that the group theory said that the group which becomes dominant tries to tilt the public policy in their favor. So that is how you say the public policy reflects the interest of the dominant group. But however, the policy is designed in such a way that the interest of all the groups are negotiated and the public policy is arrived. It is democratic in the sense that all groups can participate in the process of influencing policy making. Now, here what you find is that one challenge of this group theory is that they just overlook how in the process of policy making, the demands of the losing group is fading out. The demands of the losing group is not being reflected in the public policy. That is how society becomes inegalitarian, inequality persists in society, popular discontentment develops in society, and these were the challenges for the group theory. Now also some theorists, they talked about that policy making is a rational exercise. It is nothing non-scientific about it, because man is a rational, every human being is a rational being, a thinking animal, has a thinking mind, has a scientific temper. So every human being is trying to take the decision after much thought. So therefore, it is a rational exercise. So since policy making is a collective exercise, now every policy is a reflection of collective decision, and it is an intellectual endeavor. It's a choice among many policy alternatives. It maximizes the net value achievement. You know, it equates rationality with efficiency. All these the policymakers does just to have efficient policies, just to be nearer to the goal. It is very, very logical and a factual document. You know, it's a result of planning, much discussion, much analysis. You know, it's a result of cost-benefit analysis. Let me tell you here, we must recollect the model given by Herbert Simon, whose model is given as a rational model. There, Herbert Simon says that policy making is a three-stage process: intelligence, design activity, and choice. Now, what is this intelligence? Scanning the environment for conditions calling for decision. That means if you are an administrator, you have to initiate process. Like, you know, the Open University prioritize the problem that now in Corona, what is required is delivery of teaching, you know, in a remote method. So that is how the problem has been addressed. So first is intelligence. Is to identify the problem. Second is to explore all policy alternatives, possible policy alternatives, which will provide solution to the problem. Third is the choice, when you are making a choice between policy alternatives. So when at the stage of policy alternative, Herbert Simon said, there are many constraints. You know, first is the societal values. Which value predominates in the given society, in the given environment? Second is that constraint of time. You might be having insufficient data or information, which will be the basis of policy making. Then third is the technology you have for cost-benefit analysis. You might not be having the appropriate technology for cost-benefit analysis. In the process, what happens to that, you know, the again, another thing is that the policymaker might be having some social preferences, which will be reflected in the public policy. So in the process, the public policy is not irrational, but nearer to the rationality. It is not absolutely rational. That is why Herbert Simon used a word, bounded rationality. And he said, every decision is a satisficing decision. That means it is satisfactory plus sufficient enough in the given environment. So that is how the public policy is a rational and scientific exercise. Similarly, we have another approach, that is the systems approach, which was given by David Easton. Now, David Easton, the political scientist who talked about behavioralism, who talked about post-behavioralism, and he again refined his methodology to systems approach. Now, David Easton said,
hello, is there an issue? Hello.
Wait. Vignesh?
Yes, sir.
Okay, there is a technical problem.
No, sir. Sir, problem sort out, sir.
Okay, fine. So, later come. The question is, she was very lucidly explaining what is public policy, approaches to public policy. ଏବଂ ଅତି ପ୍ରାଞ୍ଜଳ ଭାବରେ ମ୍ୟାଡମ୍ ବୁଝାଉଥିଲେ ହାରୋଲ୍ଡ ଲାସୱେଲଙ୍କର ଥିଓରୀ, ଡାନିଏଲ ଲର୍ନରଙ୍କର ଥିଓରୀ, ହର୍ବର୍ଟ ସାଇମନଙ୍କ ଥିଓରୀ, ଇନଷ୍ଟିଟ୍ୟୁସନାଲ ଆପ୍ରୋଚ୍ ଟୁ ପବ୍ଲିକ ପଲିସି ମେକିଂ, ଏଲିଟିଷ୍ଟ ଆପ୍ରୋଚ୍ ଟୁ ପବ୍ଲିକ ପଲିସି ମେକିଂ, ଗ୍ରୁପ୍ ଥିଓରୀ ରିଲେଟେଡ୍ ଟୁ ପଲିସି ମେକିଂ, ଏଗୁଡ଼ାକ ସବୁ ଥିଓରିଟିକାଲ ଡାଇମେନ୍ସନ୍ସ ଦେଉଥିଲେ. ମୁଁ ଭାବୁଛି ତାଙ୍କର ସେକେଣ୍ଡ ପାର୍ଟ ଅଫ୍ ହର୍ ପ୍ରେଜେଣ୍ଟେସନ୍ରେ ସେ ଆକ୍ଚୁଆଲ ପବ୍ଲିକ ପଲିସି ମେକିଂ କେମିତି ହୁଏ, who are participating in public policy making, and how public policies are made. Kind of no policy is made in a vacuum. Policies are always made for the people, but the question is who makes those public policy, that is more important. Ebong jota se Pooja Singh ra prashna thila je what is elitist theory, I think madam was answering that question. ଆମେ ଡେମୋକ୍ରାସିକର ଡିଫାଇନ୍ କରୁଛୁ ଆବ୍ରାହମ ଲିଙ୍କନଙ୍କର ଯେ ଡେମୋକ୍ରାସି ଇଜ୍ ଏ government of the people, for the people, by the people. But in fact, the elitist theories say that democracy is a government of the people, for the people, and by the elites. So, Madam Ashikalani, so please, Madam, I was filling up the gap. Don't worry. Go on.
Thank you.
Yes, he's here. Welcome again. Please go ahead.
So we were discussing about the systems approach. Now, the systems approach right now has become old for us. But a very important part of the systems approach is that, you know, the David Easton said that demands, supports, resources come to the system, which are outside the political system, come to the system as inputs. Political system in a black box process those things, which we will discuss, and the result is, output is the public policies. Public policies come in the form of goods and services to us. And finally, what happens is the outcome of the public policy. Now, remember, students, there is a difference between output and outcome. The public policy is itself is the output, and the impact of public policy is the outcome of the public policy. Now, how the systems approach told us that a very, very important concept, that is feedback. That means once the, it's a cyclical process. Once the public policy is made, then feedback start coming from the environment. And those feedbacks get processed into demands and supports and resources and enter into the political system. Knock the door of the political system along with the problems. And finally, the political system responds in the form of public policies. Now, today we are now focusing more on this feedback. If the feedback is successful, if the process of feedback is successful, if the process of feedback is broad-based, then democracy becomes broad-based and the social base of democracy get expanded. So that is how, though systems approach has become an old theory for us today, but the concept that they gave us, the feedback concept, that is very, very important for us. Now, the recent approach, which many a times we use the word that every public policy is incremental in nature. It is just touching the problem, touching the periphery of the problem, doesn't address the problem in an integrated way. So that is the analysis of the incremental theorist, and the main advocate of this incremental model is Charles Lindblom, who died in 2018, you know, the theory says that public policy is a continuation of previous policies with minimum changes. Existing programs provides base for policymaking. Policymakers accept previous policies because of uncertainty about the consequences of the new policy. Now, let me tell you here one example that today there are much intellectual debate on reservation as a public policy. Whether reservation is contributing towards inclusive growth of the marginalized social groups or not. The discourses in social science are divided. Reservation is not serving the purpose. Again, it is just being cornered by a selected few. Actually, it is not giving benefits to the broader group. Some say no, reservation is actually serving the purpose. It is creating a labeling field for the marginalized social groups. Now you see, whatever reformations we are bringing on this public policy, that they are, you know, bits and pieces. Sometimes we say that it cannot be more than 50%. This was the decision of the Supreme Court. Sometimes we say, no, no, the people, the youth from the general category who are poor, they're left behind. So recently we have introduced the EWS category. So this is the finest example of incremental public policy. I will also talk about another example, MGNREG. Now, government is critical of that MGNREG as a public policy, but government is not getting rid of this public policy because it addresses the societal value, that is socialism, and it addresses the ideology of the society. It addresses the certain social issues and economic issues. So government is reformulating the policy in bits and pieces. So many a times today, we feel that most probably this incremental model is most important. Now, many theorists have added another approach to this list of approaches, that is public choice theory, which is basically, you know, it's applying economics to analyze public policy. It's the political economy approach, which you can place this public choice approach prior to the new public management approach, because the public choice theory developed an analysis of public policy in such a vigorous way that every student political science started, you know, dissecting every part of public policy and trying to know what is the vested interest behind this public policy, whether the public policy is public in nature or not. That was the main concern. So that is how the public choice theory said, you know, public policy is not at all public in nature. These are reflections of or compilations of private interests meddled into public. That means the policy makers are actually fulfilling their private interest in the name of giving larger benefits to the common man. So this was the criticism of the public choice theory. So every policy analysis today is not free from this public choice approach. Now, public choice approach became so vigorous that it ultimately resulted in developing another broad approach, that is the new public management approach, which said that instead of making public policy more bureaucratic, we can make it more managerial by adopting many scientific methods, about which actually Herbert Simon in 1950s was talking about, like simulation, mathematical models, at use of artificial intelligence to arrive at a more efficient and rational public policy. Now, we have discussed more or less about the approaches to public policy. Now, I must tell you here, the policy making process, you know, I have told about functional dimension of public policy, formulation, implementation, and evaluation. Now, policy making process is a cyclical process. You prepare the policy. The policy itself, the policy document is a planned document. It includes within itself the implementing mechanisms, and also how will it be evaluated, how the impact of the public policy will be evaluated. And in the process, we are arriving at another public policy. So when today we are focusing on public policy, or we are teaching public policy, it is just not just not inputs on how the policies are made, rather the inputs include how the policy will be monitored for better result, how the policy will be evaluated by a third party, the party which is not involved in policy making, the party which is also not the beneficiary of the policy, but a third party who is nowhere related to that public policy. That third party will evaluate the impact of the public policy. So this is how you see the policy cycle process is becomes a circular process. Now it's a vicious circle. You can, if the policy is successful, you say it's a virtuous cycle. If the policy is not successful, you say it's a vicious circle which only satisfies the vested interest. Because, you know, when people started talking about the group theory to the study of public policy, they said that why there is no development, proper development in the agriculture sector in India? Why the land management is not proper? It is because critics say that big farmer lobby has dominated policy making so far as the agricultural sector is concerned. And if you talk about the industrial policies, people, those who are critical of the government, they say capitalists are the big industrial houses have influenced the industrial policy resolution. That is how the whatever policy the government is making, it is favoring the capitalist class. All of you know that in social science, we have two broad perspectives. Either you analyze the public policy from a liberal framework, or you analyze the public policy from a Marxist perspective. You need to analyze the nature of the state. So today, all these policies, you know, the public choice approach, the rational policy making approach, the systems approach, the incremental approach, all these approaches taken together are adopted by the researchers to make a policy analysis and to suggest how the government will come out with a better public policy. And for that, today we have a group of a group of professionals who are specifically focusing on policy analysis. They are well versed with the scientific techniques, the technological know-how, how to evaluate the policy, how to get the impact analysis, and that is how they are giving good inputs to the government so that the government can come out with better public policy. Now, if you just have an analysis of the present COVID-19 situation, how the government has arrived at a public policy of shifting the migrant workers population to their home states. It is because now the democracy has become broad-based. And government today are taking note of the public opinion expressed in the form of opinions of civil society organizations who are specifically engaged in research and working with those marginalized sections. They better know the problems of the stakeholders. So that is how the government is not like previously, the government is not, you know, negative towards all these opinions expressed by the society. The government welcomes these opinions, government responds to these opinions. Currently, the government is thinking of shifting the migrant workers to their home states. So this is how, you know, public policy is influenced, public policy is made and remade time and again, formulated and reformulated by addressing the societal values, the problems in the given environment, and the the rational analysis of all the alternatives and adopts that alternative which is feasible, which doesn't have negative repercussions for the society. That is how today public policy is made. So as the democracy is becoming more and more broad-based, the public policy is becoming more and more rational and efficient and effective, because it takes note of the requirements of all the stakeholders. You know, the government, before making a legislation, before making a public policy, seeks the responses of the citizens through a web portal. We might not give our responses, but government seeks the responses, gives a timeline, and within that we need to give our responses, and government will take note of all those responses and try to make a public policy which will be nearer to the goal and which will be more efficient and effective. I think I should stop here because it's already 12 o'clock, isn't it? Or I can continue?
Yes, ma'am, continue.
There is another model which people talk about. Let me tell you, garbage can model. It is a critique of the systems approach. It advocates that organizations function like garbage cans, you know, the waste basket, into which a mix of problems and possible solutions are poured, mixed together. Mixed together and determining the decision outcome. So they said that there is nothing called rationality actually. It's all, it's just an incremental approach. So more or less today the critics are appreciating the incremental approach that the theorist Charles Lindblom gave us. And here I must tell you another approach about Jeskyll Drawer. Drawer talked about, you know, different stages of policy making, meta policy, and that is how he says it is also a reflection of the incremental approach, or you can say it is a reflection of the multidisciplinary content that was told by Harold Laswell in the beginning, that the government just draws the broad outline of a meta policy, and then after that, in different stages, the policies are formulated in bits and pieces. The major policy is formulated like we formulated reservation as a public policy when we drafted the constitution itself in the constituent assembly. We decided reservation as a public policy, decided in favor of that. And gradually, we are continuing with that meta policy, with that framework, and trying to add more elements to it. So that is how draw a major theorist in public administration analyzes the policymaking process. Now I would like to answer the questions.
Okay, Professor Tripathi, thank you so much for a wonderful presentation. In fact, I was listening and I was very happy for a very lucid explanation of approaches to public policy. In fact, let me, before the questions are asked by the students, let me tell you that I have been telling my colleague Vigneshwar
Yes.
To develop a small module, online course on policy, public policy making. In fact, I have been trying to do this for last 1 year. So your presentation today will definitely help us to give a theoretical background to public policy making, because you quoted so many political philosophers, social philosophers like Daniel Lerner, Harold Lassell, Herbert Simon. You talked about institutional approach, elitist theory, group theory, systems approach, and talked about output-input analysis and with it the best and how policies are made and the process that is being followed in public policy making. Now, I'll preserve this video for an online course. Thank you very much.
Thank you, thank you.
Hello. Madam, which question is asking? Hello?
I will take 1 minute.
Go ahead, business sir, ask the question.
Yes, sir.
Madam is just coming, so you can ask the questions one by one. I hope the students are writing down the questions in the chat board.
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes.
Madam, first question is from Pooja Singh. What is LT theory?
Elite theory.
Okay.
Yes.
I have already explained it. Let me tell you that elite theory is talking about a society where the society is not democratic in true sense of the term. Though the society has a liberal democratic state and the people are getting voting right, but they do not have any say in policy making. The society is divided into two groups, elites and non-elites. The non-elites are not interested, like we have, you know, theory X and theory Y. Here they say that the people are not interested in policy making. The people are not interested how the government is functioning. The people are interested only in getting services. So that is why the elite try to keep the people in darkness and serves its own purpose and makes policies which will serve its own interest. Now, this elite theory, which says that the society has a very handful of elites, and the elites get changed. There is circulation of elites, but the group itself doesn't allow others to enter into the group. So the society is managed by only a selected few. And those selected few are called as the elites. They make the public policy. They enjoy the sovereignty. It is actually people are not taken into account. People are not asked. They decide about the policy thinking that they are the best representative of the people, whatever they like. So this elite theory was later on, you know, took the shape of, you can say, public choice approach. It gave food for thought to the public choice theorist. I hope it's okay.
Madam, second question is, hello?
Yes.
Madam, is public policy political homogeneity?
Public policy has, you know, at the outset, you can say when the policy has already been made, it has political homogeneity because all political ideologies accept it. But prior to policy making, there are much negotiation behind the scene, much negotiation on the table, which the system theorists have called as black box. We do not know what happens there. We do not know who are the opposers and who are the supporters of public policy. But policy making is itself a political process. We cannot say that policy making is non-political unless and until the government takes into account the views of all political parties. There will be a crisis of legitimacy for the government. Now you can observe the policy making process in the COVID-19, because we are all in lockdown. We have enough time to observe. The government is time and again having video conferencing with the chief ministers, with the political party leaders. Government had an all-party meeting also. With the people's representatives, the government had a video conferencing with the sarpanchas. So this is how, you know, the government is trying to neutralize all types of conflicting political opinions. So at the outset, you can say public policy is politically homogeneous. But if you, you know, analyze the policy-making process, it neutralizes all diverse political opinion within itself. It includes all diverse political opinion within itself.
Madam, next question is,
yes,
how many types of approaches to the policy cycle?
Policy cycle is actually a universal concept. This is an analysis by which we say that how the policy is made. You have approaches to the study of public policy. We just analyze the policy making process. That is called policy cycle. The policy process itself. We are not talking about the content of the policy. The policy making process itself, which says that we have first the agenda setting. Now, this is the understanding of Wildavsky, a very important theorist in public policy, who said we have agenda setting, we have issue analysis, we have implementation, evaluation. Then if the public policy is not good enough, then we terminate the public policy. There we can go for another meta policy. We just can have a new policy, like we have the reservation for EWS category. It was not there in the country. So this is how you see, you will better understand public policy if all the time you just try to pick up certain examples from the environment when you are reading public policy, a book or any study material, that will give you a better understanding.
Next, is it madam, okay? Madam, next question is, what is the relevance of public policy in times of a pandemic?
Oh, it's highly relevant. When you have a pandemic, how can you address the pandemic? Because, you know, initially I told you public administration is clinical in nature. Administrators are just like doctors. They are in charge of making the public policy, like a doctor is prescribing the treatment. So when you have a pandemic, you know, gote mahamari, se mahamari pai puni samaste bichar karikiri gote niti prastuta kariba darkar, jothire ki samastankar subidha hai pariba, samastankar asubidha taku ame address kari pariba. So, and what is important is that in a pandemic, you know, the leader, you see, the prime minister is time and again consulting different stakeholders, because a mistake means the state will lose many lives. People will not forget the political party or the leader if people in large numbers die. And the state is not responding to the cause. So, and the right now the government tries its level best to make the public policy more and more rational, and the goal is to address the pandemic so that Indians, all social groups in India, will not be affected by the pandemic. So whenever there is any suggestion from the civil society, the government is immediately responding to that. This is how the public policy is made.
Madam, next question is, how to implement public policy and what is the procedure?
See, previously, let me tell you, previously that means if we talk about the post-independent India of 1950s or 60s, that time the institution which was in charge of implementing public policies, the executive was implementing the public policy. And the implementation part was not there in the public policy. Many public policies did not contain the implementation mechanism. But today, every public policy has implementation mechanism. Like, take for example, Odisha Right to Public Service Act 2012. In the act itself, the implementation mechanism has been mentioned. The Food Security Act, in the act itself, the implementation mechanism has been mentioned. So as per the implementation mechanism, take the Right to Information Act, there the implementation mechanism has been mentioned. So the implementation mechanism is itself a legislation, is a part of the law. So now nobody can change the implementation mechanism. Now, as per the implementation mechanism, the executive implements the public policy.
Madam, next question is from Soumen Mukherjee from Calcutta. He's asking, Drawer's rational policy-making model, please explain.
I have already explained you that Drawer's policy-making process, it has, you know, a long steps, many steps. Meta policy making, then the next step, I'm not able to recollect. The whole policy making process is divided into three stages. And that is how Drawer says, initially we have the broad policy, then we have the next stage where we just narrow down the policy, then the third stage where we just focus on the area to which the policy is to be implemented.
Madam, next question is, please explain the role of bureaucracy in policy making. A question from Kanti Leta Karkata.
Bureaucracy is a major instrument in policy-making process because the ministers are laymen. They do not have expertise. And in the process, what you find is that the bureaucracy under the minister provides the data and information to the minister. So the whole, you know, the minister may identify the area. But the bureaucrat itself is making all design activity, exploring all policy alternatives, making a cost-benefit analysis out of it. And the choice is a scientific and rational decision. So all work is done by the bureaucrat. The bureaucrats, the bureaucracy, that means I don't say that it is the top-level bureaucracy. I say that the bureaucracy, top level, middle level, and the lower level, all are involved in the policy making process. When we make a budget, if you just analyze the budget making process, the whole bureaucracy is involved in budget making. So that is how the bureaucracy is involved. That is why how the public choice theory came out. That is how Peter Drucker said, government commits 3 CM, 6 sins, chhota papa sarkar kare. What is it? No, it is it has lofty objectives which can never be fulfilled. Health for all. It doesn't know how to abandon useless public policies. It doesn't rethink, you know, so on and so forth. So that is how you see. Peter Drucker says bureaucracy is fat and flabby. It just expands horizontally and vertically, does nothing. And that is how the public choice theory came into being. It gave a call for de-bureaucratization. And we also say that bureaucracy creates bottlenecks for development in a developmental state. Because bureaucracy is the main instrument involved in policy making, policy implementation, and policy evaluation. How it is involved in policy evaluation? Now we have a third party. Now the bureaucrat knows how to manage it. The evaluation will be done by some party which is favorable to the government. Then the party doesn't come out with critical appreciation of the public policy. So the public policy is not evaluated properly. So the bureaucracy is responsible for all these three stages, functional dimensions of policy making. Policy making, formulation, implementation, and evaluation. Okay?
Madam, a question from Romy Ranjan. He's writing, is there any relevance of a garbage can model of policy making in Indian democracy?
Garbage can model, if you believe in it, it can be an instrument to analyze a public policy anywhere and everywhere, even in India. Because what the garbage can model says, the garbage can model says that there is a garbage can where the solutions are put, the problems are put. And basically the garbage can model says there is no policy analysis of policy alternatives. It's just an incremental decision. So if you, as a researcher, want to use it, you can use it. But it is not that appropriate. It is not that appreciable.
Madam, a question from Priyanka Patnaik. So he's writing, sometimes we see in India that central policies are not acceptable by the many states. So ma'am, is that time we need a meta policy?
What is the context? What central policies are acceptable by the states?
Are not accepted by the states, many states.
Okay. Accepted or not accepted by many states when the states are given option. So far as the constitution, the states are bound to accept any policy made by the central government. Otherwise, the central government will say that there is a failure of constitutional machinery in the state. You know, in a democracy, the states are given freedom to accept the central policy in a broader perspective or absolutely. What happens when you have ideological differences like the West Bengal, like Odisha? They say that we need to address any issue on the basis of our requirement of the society. What the society requires, accordingly, what the environment demands, accordingly, we should provide a solution. So therefore, the center has declared that there is a national lockdown, but the states are taking liberty and following the lockdown, which will suit them. That is how you see, if the states are not following lockdown rigidly, then you have more increase in the number of cases of corona. So, and in certain cases also, like I would here give an example. The OBC list, our state has added some castes to the OBC list, and Odisha has a SCBC list where some castes have been added to the OBC list because we think those castes are the marginalized groups in our society, Odisha society. So it is not necessary that the state should accept the central government policy in an absolute sense. They have to adapt to the local needs by keeping in mind the meta policy. They cannot violate the meta policy. That is why the three stages of policy.
My next question is, can policy science and public policy both are equal or any difference?
Public policy, research and teaching of public policy is the content of policy science. Policy, public policy is an offshoot of policy science. And let me tell you, policy science is an offshoot of political science. After the behavioralism began, we started making many studies of the political behavior of the leaders. Now our horizon extended. Then we started talking in terms of public policy. See, if you just go through the life and work of David Easton, you can just get an idea how the evolution of political science research has developed. David Easton was a behavioralist. David Easton became a post-behavioralist. Then David Easton became a system theorist, which is basically an approach to the study of public policy. Okay?
Ma'am, next question is, one more question, ma'am.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, yes. I'm
what
here.
Are the model? Yes, ma'am. What are the models of public policy making?
What are the models of public policy making? These the approaches that I have talked about. These are also called as models of policy making. Now, what is an approach? Approach is basically, let me tell you what is an approach, then you will be then you can understand what is a model. Approach or a model is a means or a basic analytical tool for studying the political activities of the government in policy science or in political science. Because it is a basic analytical tool to understand how governance is done in a state. And every public policy is a reflection of governance model. So that means the basically the models we discussed, you can call them as approaches or you can call them as models. Okay?
Ma'am, last questions.
Yes.
Madam, explain analysis of public policy and analysis for public policy.
Okay. One is talking about the content, analysis of public policy. It is talking about the content of public policy. Mm-hmm. Analysis for public policy is talking about the process of public policy, how the public policy is made. How it's just like a policy cycle that we are talking about. How the policy making is done, how policy is formulated. Okay.
Okay, madam. Thank you, ma'am.
Any other question?
Okay, very very lively discussion. Interesting questions. I hope you must have enjoyed answering these questions. Now I would like to invite one or two students who were basically asking these questions to unmute their mic and come forward and give their views to madam. Unmute your mic. We want to see you also. Priyanka, you have asked so many questions. Would you like to come? Samir Swai. Vasudev Padhi, Richard Barik.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
For today's class, I got all the things and I'm already clear what are the models of the public policy. I got that, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay.
Thank you. Are you happy?
Yes, sir.
Very good. Very good. What are you doing?
Sir, actually now I am working as an academic in charge in Vedic Group of Institutions, Sambalpur.
Acha, you are in Vedic Group in Sambalpur?
Yes, sir.
Your name is Richard Barry. Richard is a very Western name.
Thank you, sir.
Good. Very good. Well done, Richard. Anybody else?
Hello.
Samir.
Hello, madam.
Yes. Samir.
Madam.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Madam. Madam, please explain lockdown or the curfew in COVID-19 issue. Who are the recover this corona? Please.
Lockdown and curfew.
We thought
a legal professional will be able to explain it properly, but as a commoner, what madam. I say. कर्फ्यू आई थिंक जो 144 धारा जारी होची हमें केही बाहर को बाहर परिवनी बेसी लोक एकाठी हेई परिवनी एंड लॉकडाउन यू नो द गवर्नमेंट इज यू आर इन वी आर इन लॉकडाउन स्टेज वी अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज लॉकडाउन वी आर ऑल इनसाइड द हाउस एंड ओनली वी हैव एक्सेस टू एसेंशियल्स वी कैन नॉट गो आउट ऑफ द हाउस देयर इज नो ट्रांसपोर्ट एंड कम्युनिकेशन. All shops are closed.
Samir, any?
But it is not a curfew situation.
Comments.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, madam.
Madam, का presentation बहुत लगला कि नहीं हुआ?
Hello, madam.
Sir, ठीक लगला. Sir, बहुत लगला. Sir, बहुत लगला.
पूजी पारी ला.
Thank you.
Hello, madam.
समस्त पूजी पारी ले.
Next.
Sir, madam.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Okay, Asit.
Jai Jagannath, madam.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Jai Jagannath. Madam, बहुत बहुत लगेला class की मते बाकी मुटिक के अभुजा रही वाली बहुत माने.
Thank you. माने ओडिया रे कहिले ही चंता ना कौनो.
नहीं madam. चलती नहीं. Actually madam ठीक है slow बते मतलब लगेला मुटिक out टिक के वाले maybe ये डा fast मोपाई बदने सती पे ऐसे लगेला. Madam,
but my suggestion, bohi padho tike.
I guess, sir, sahi thi bhai. Madam, mu chahutli ki apan ko emti kichi ki alga ketar problem hale mu apan contact kar paribi.
Bilkul contact karibo. You can take the phone number from your academic consultant or from your office. And you can call me anytime if you are having any difficulty. Pachari paribo kichi asubidha nahi.
Thank you, madam. Thank you. Sir, tikke pachari. Chaun tikke madam. Tikke madam. Late asli. Tenu kori morte. Bujhi parle ni fast fast jodo.
Na aji aji ro actually bichar ta itte besi wide thila je. Mote bohu ta ko precise kori kahiwa kuhela. Kana approach gula ko जेमती के हार्वर्ड साइकल का मॉडल को पढ़ाया भी गुट्टे क्लास दरकार गुट्टे घंटा दरकार सब जिन सब को कंपाइल करी पढ़ाया को है ना ठीक है छोटो छोटो करी पढ़ाया
को हाँ मैडम तो इस स्पीड स्पीड पढ़ो थे लेकिन मैं आउट की मैंने धारी पढ़ना थे लेकिन अभी मुंह स्लो ही है इतने ठीक है
अच्छा
नेक्स्ट टाइम बहुत ही पढ़ के अपन
यू रीड द यू रीड द बुक एंड इफ यू फाइंड एनी डिफिकल्टी गिव मी अ कॉल
थैंक यू
ओके बिगनेस प्लीज कम फॉरवर्ड
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
Thank you, ma'am. It was a wonderful session. And Sadhuvada Devi, Odisha Rajya Mukta Vishwavidyalaya ra Sanmaniya Kulapati Mahodaya Jingu, ji ete bada decision neichanti ki ei bhaliya pandemic situation re gote doorstep education diya hochi.
Yes, exactly.
Thank you, sir.
I also enjoyed the class very much.
I know that you'll enjoy it and it is a lovely experience. So we are connected to people, we are connected to our students, we are connected with friends also. I mean, isolated lockdown, we are not isolated, we are connected. That is more important.
Yes. It's a great initiative.
Thank you very much. So thank you, friends, my colleague, Dr. Professor Swarnamai Tripathi, dear learners, our technical team, and above all, Mr. Bigleshwar Raut, who is an academic consultant in Orissa State Open University. I thank you. And please, I just want to inform all of you that this program has been recorded, and we will develop a video out of it, and it will be uploaded on the university website. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
I once again thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Sonoy. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.